Gavin, what's going on, man? What are you up to these days?
Hanging, doing our best to get away from the road noise, which you hear a little bit of. After tour, between tours, you know, while you're working on stuff, it's just good to get away from the city and get normal again, you know.
What's currently on your mind?
Currently on my mind, I put together this Christmas record, you know. Funny thing about Christmas records is you make them in July usually. It's kind of a joke within the music business. We call it Christmas in July because that's when you start prepping for your Christmas stuff, which is why there's no snow on the ground and we're talking about Christmas. But it'll get chilly tonight here anyway because we're in the mountains. It's mostly quiet and I get to let the dog off the leash, which is awesome. You know, we spend a lot of time in hotel rooms and condos and stuff like that, and in urban environments, and I start feeling real guilty about Buddy not getting be normal like a dog should, and he should be out here getting his paws dirty. So come down here, get by the river, and get normal.
If you couldn't be Gavin DeGraw, who would you be?
I couldn't be myself. Who would I be? If I couldn't be me. See, that's the thing. I think that's the only market you can corner is yourself, really. No real other options. I had a really cool memory, not on stage, but backstage. With Greg Allman. That was particularly cool. And this was after I had been on the road with Greg. And, I had asked my agent at the time, years ago, hey, man, I'd like to go out and open up for the Allman Brothers because I know you handle them. And this is long after Dwayne Allman had passed, obviously, but they're still under the name the Allman Brothers. And Greg had invited me out to sing Midnight Rider with him, which, of course, was like a huge childhood dream of mine because as a teenager, me and my brother used to play in bar bands and stuff and cover Midnight Rider. So that also was a big one for me, singing with Greg. But one day we were backstage, he and I, and we were doing this gig in L.A. And a bunch of other acts were on it, like great acts, you know, a bunch of great acts were on it. I think Crosby, Stills, and Nash was on the gig, Michael Bublé was on the gig, a bunch of dudes. And I think Maroon 5 was on that gig. It's just one of those crazy gigs where a bunch of people are on it. And me and Greg are backstage, and we're just nerding out on music, just talking music, before each of us had to go out and sing our respective songs. And we just started talking about Ray Charles, and he started singing just the whole Ray Charles songbook, song after song, referencing songs, talking about songs. Oh, do you know this one? Do you know this one? I like when he does this during this song. And Greg was just singing one song after the next, just to me, real quiet, like from me to you. And that was a very cool, very special memory for me as a musician. That's way up there on the memory list for sure. My brother gave me this pretty awesome present recently. He knows I'm a big James Bond fan, right? Even like the Lazenby Bond, you know what I mean? Like, I think that was an amazing one. And he was all excited to give me this gift, you know? And I was wondering, what the hell did he get me, you know, my brother? So, bust out this big picture frame. It was all of the autographs of each actor who had ever played Bond. Beautiful collection, you know, just everything, including Lazenby. I was like, how did you find that, you know? And that was a pretty unbelievable gift. It's a good question. I don't know, hard to say. As far as like living and enjoying your life, I don't really follow the traditional rules of waiting to make plans to do shit that you want to do and stuff like that. And I just kind of when I want to do something, I just kind of, honestly, I just go do it. I don't wait till all of the stars align for my plan. Yeah, I think that's a real waste of time. I like good food, but I don't cook. It's just tough for me being outdoors. You know, cooking meat on a fire is different than, you know, running a commercial kitchen. I don't need fine dining in that way. It's funny, you know, a lot of people, they go to a fine dining restaurant to have a slab of meat that somebody's cooking on a fire. You know, just like that. Right on a campfire, really, is what you can do. You know, just fine dining, you know. I'm all about it. Cool. I love it. But in some ways, it's ironic. After my mom passed, I was out in L.A., with the best buddy of mine, and he loved to camp. And he goes, wanna go to the desert, man? I said, yeah, hell yeah. And I figured we'd drive an hour or so out of LA. Well, man, fuck, man, I couldn't tell you how many hours later it was. 3 hours, four hours, wherever the hell it was. We're coming out some fire road, whatever, something that my vehicle wasn't made to go down. Shaking the hell out of this thing. It was a ride. Anyway, we got out there. He cooked up some cool food. And then next day, he's like, where you want to go, man? I was like, just keep going. I don't remember where the hell we went next. And then after that, he goes, yeah, I got to head back to, you know, to work or whatever. I said, I'm going to keep going. And I hit the highway. And a few hours later, I was refueling. And this tractor trailer went by. And that dog ran out of the road. And I was like, oh shit, you know? So I'm like fueling up, holding these McNuggets like this, you know? So I pegged him with a couple McNuggets, you know? And he hid him behind some lamppost or whatever. And I was like, oh shit, this dog is homeless, man. He's hiding food. He's storing food like a damn squirrel. And he popped out and I was like, get over here. And he trotted up and he sat right down on my foot. He looked up at me just like this. And I spent about an hour and a half there at the gas station, like asking people, hey, is this anybody's dog? Is anybody's dog? You know, and he smelled like skunk. And I was like, well, fuck it. This is a nice dog, you know, I don't care. Put him in the vehicle and I took him to Nashville and had him cleaned up. He had worms and fleas and they found a chip in him, but he was unregistered. So I said to the vet, what should I do? He's unregistered. What do I do now? They said, well, he's yours if you want him, or, you know. I said, or what? They said, well, we put him in a shelter. I said, well, then they're going to kill him. I said, I'll take him. I'll take the dog. He's too nice. I tried to see if my dad wanted him. He was like, that's your dog, Gavin. He'll die for you right now. I had him 2 days. It's like, you know, look at him. Damn handsome. Favorite lyric, any song ever, is a Bob Dylan lyric from a song called Boots of Spanish Leather. And it goes just like this. If I had the stars of the darkest night and the diamonds of the deepest ocean, I'd forsake them all for your sweet kiss, for that's all I'm wishing to be owning. That's it. That's the best song line ever written. If I'm the lead singer, well, that would be tough, because pretty much all my favorite musicians are singers, and I'd like to shut up and hear them do what they do. Pavarotti, Frank Sinatra, Sam Cooke. I mean, our band would suck at instruments. But I mean, you know, it would be worth it. It would be an a cappella group, is what it would be. Guilty pleasure, probably Neil Diamond. I love Neil Diamond. I think he's so cool. And Wayne Newton. I love Wayne Newton. Wayne Newton's live show is one of the greatest shows I've ever seen. He's 81 or 82 years old, and gets on stage, tells great stories, looks at every single person in the audience in the eye, smiles at them, talks with them, sings to them. It was a masterclass in relatability from the stage. I don't have much of a ritual pre-show other than kind of make some funny noises with my voice just to feel what's working and what's not. Feeling out the spots in your voice that are a little beat up, a little dried out. Kind of like stretching before a game. You know, you're just seeing what hurts and, you know, where the stiff parts are, and just a way of just feeling out your chords, and that's about it. I don't watch sports much. You know, I do like ice hockey because it's a fast game. You know, I like contact sports. We played contact sports growing up, and you know, back when you could actually hit somebody playing basketball, and you'd have to say stay 15 feet away. I like seeing people go for it. That's what I'm trying to say. You know, I don't know. I'm pretty middle of the road guy. Man, when I was playing music, when I was starting out, the last thing I thought about was what I'm wearing. Last thing. And I was concerned with, hey, how am I singing, you know, and writing songs and getting my craft together. I really am authentically a music lover, you know. Binge watch, most recent, Empire Games, pretty great. I don't know if you've ever seen that. You ever seen Empire Games? Damn good. Probably tell you one that annoys my brother the most. It's not a phrase, it's just a word. It's when I say the word bro. Because he'll say, you only have one brother, Gavin. You know, so my brother takes it very offensively when I call anybody else bro. My last meal. Man. Tell you what, man. It's hard to beat a rib cap. Pretty great. I'm gonna rib cap spoil you. But at the same time, no bullshit. It's hard to beat a fucking hot dog. So, I mean, you know, what can I say? They seem far away from each other, but one's almost as good as the other one. You can never tell which. I think my natural gift was right away singing, honestly. But I don't know if it's because I was good at it or just because I did it all the time right away. Something I was passionate about early on. You tend to become skilled in the thing you're most passionate about because no one has to tell you to practice. You're just doing it anyway. And so my career or my job came about not necessarily because I was talented, it's because I loved something so much that I got just good enough at it early on enough that I can make a living at it. Probably wearing a more worn out version of the same shirt here, living in the mountains. I don't know. Moonlighting as a ski instructor. You know what I mean? Wearing a full face mask. You know, giving lessons.